About Dogs on VCTV is supported by the Berks County Kennel Club and by the Berks County Dog Training Club.
Good evening, and welcome to the Berks County Kennel Club's program, All About Dogs. Hi, I'm Pat Mock, your host. And this evening, we're going to sort of continue with the program that we started last month. Last month, we had talked about how to pick a puppy. This month, we're going to talk about how to pick a breeder. So our guests this evening are Nancy Ryder with the Dalmatian and Candy Bowl with the Corgi puppy. Well, they're both puppies, but one puppy is a little bit older than the other puppy. When I say pick a breeder, you decided that you want a puppy. You sort of found a person that has the breed that you're interested in, however you found them, hopefully you called the Kennel Club. But before you even go to look at that litter of puppies, there are some questions that you want to ask the person when you call them on the telephone. So that's what we're going to be doing with our guests this evening. We're going to be asking them some of the questions that you definitely should ask the person that you're considering buying a puppy from before you go to see the puppies. Once you get to see the puppies, you know, if you just go and see the puppies, it's like, you don't care what they look like. They're puppies, they're adorable, and just wait until you see this little corgi puppy. Everybody is going to want to take it home. Unfortunately, the owner has planned on keeping this one, but all puppies are cute. So you're already going to fall into the trap of, I'm going to take a puppy no matter what. So these are questions you ask before you go to see that litter of puppies. And the first question I would ask, and I'm going to ask both of these ladies, basically, how long have you been breeding?
Well, let's see. I have been breeding probably now for about 42, 43 years.
Okay.
A little while. Yeah.
And always Dalmatian?
Always Dalmatian.
Okay.
Yes.
And Candy, you?
Probably, I'd say, between 25 and 27 years, and always corgis.
And always corgis. Now, why would you want to ask that question? First of all, if the person has only been breeding one breed of dog, you know that they are going to be very knowledgeable in that breed of dog. They're going to have studied the breed. They're going to have checked the backgrounds of the dogs, the health of the dogs. So they are really, really involved with their breed. If you call somebody about a puppy and you ask them, Nancy, how long they've been breeding, and they said, oh, well, we're only in this about 2 years, and we have six different kinds of dogs, what would you say, or what would you think about a person like that?
I would be rather concerned about it, simply because if you have that many litters, and for that short period of time, with that number of breeds, how can you possibly know what is the best way to go on doing a breeding? If you're doing it casually, which obviously they would be, then you're not really breeding for the betterment of the breed. You're breeding simply because you want to hopefully make some money on it, which rarely happens, mm-hmm. or you just like having a lot of puppies to take care of, which again, is not the usual thing.
Right. And it's not good for the puppies either, because they all need to be socialized. And if you have, you know, 25, 30 different puppies, or, you know, 30 puppies, how are you going to socialize those puppies? You run out of hours in the day till you feed and clean mm-hmm. up after mm-hmm. them. How are you going to socialize them?
Yeah.
You know, you can't sit and play with 30 puppies. You know, there's just not enough time in the day. Would you ask that person how they planned these breedings? Would you ask them who gave them advice? Or would you just say, no, thank you, I'm not interested?
I personally would say, no, thank you, I'm not interested. But sometimes you are going to come across a person who is only on their first litter or their second litter. And so there you have to ask them, how did they come about breeding? How did they start out? Who are they using as their mentors? Is someone monitoring what they're doing? Are they taking care of all the different health checks? Because everybody, all of us started with our first litter.
That's exactly right.
You know, we all started with the first time we were there. And I know that I had a very good mentor and I was very fortunate. And I'm assuming that Candy had the very same thing, that we had someone who was overseeing us. And we, as longtime breeders, also are mentoring other people now.
Correct.
And monitoring how they're breeding, because there has to be new breeders to take over for us. We can't do it all.
Right. We don't live well. We don't live forever, and unfortunately,
and
we all get old.
Yeah. We get old. We get tired, and we can't do what we used to do.
Correct. That's exactly right. Candy, about how many litters do you have in a year?
1 to 2 maximum.
Okay.
We don't have that many because of the amount of work.
1 maximum for me.
Okay. Well, you have more puppies than she does too.
Well, sometimes we do. We often have litters of 9 or 11, but we also have litters of 1.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's true.
Yeah.
You're planning on 9 and have 1.
Right.
But Candy, your litters aren't that large. You have what, maybe 6 max?
5 to 6.
5 to 6, okay. So they're even with just different breeds. So the Dalmatian would have 9 to 11, whereas the Corgi would have 5 to 6. So double work if you have a Dalmatian that has 11 puppies. How old are the parents? If you decide to breed a litter, how old are the parents that you would be using to breed?
The females, I don't ever breed them before they're age 2.
Okay.
Okay. I all have already, though, used males younger than that, simply because it was the right male for the female that I wanted to breed. It was a litter that had been planned probably well before the male was ever even born.
Okay.
We knew who he was going to be bred to when he was a baby puppy. And so I have already done earlier with the boys. But with the girls, we always wait until they're about 2 years of age.
Okay. Yeah, I'm assuming that you would not use a male before he has had health checks.
We do our basic health checks, but he would have been too early to be OFA'd at that point. But
what are we talking about? 6 months, 8 months,
a year? We're talking about somewhere about 9 months to a year, earliest that we'd ever use a boy dog.
Okay.
But they've already had preliminary health checks. We do on my breed, we have to do hearing testing.
Mm-hmm.
That is done when they're 7 weeks of age.
Right.
So that is already a given. We do the SURF testing, which is an eye test.
Mm-hmm.
And we start that when they're somewhere around 6 months of age.
Okay.
And then do that every year.
Okay.
The OFA for the hips, they will not actually OFA them until they are 2 years of age to get your certificate.
Right.
But they can do preliminary testing.
Yes.
So,
and what about you, Candy? Would you do the same thing, or would you breed a female earlier than 2? Or
I have in the past if they've prelimbed their hips.
Okay.
But usually it's around 2.
2, and the same with the male.
Yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. What we sort of talked about the health screenings, and I do have when I call you, and you say to me, I have health screenings done. I have OFA and SURF. How do I know that you're telling the truth and you just didn't pick up these words along the way on the internet or someplace like that?
All health organizations that screen and certify give you a certificate.
Okay.
You have printed material that you can show and say, okay, here is the OFA, here is the SURF, everything is done in actual printed material.
Okay. And
it's never just word of mouth.
Right. I do have a copy of those certificates I brought along. Now, of course, they're from my breed, but I did bring them along. Could we see a copy of the certificates? Now, this is for thyroid. With my breed, we also check for thyroid problems, just to make sure that there's not a problem in turves, but we don't want there to be a problem in turves as well. So we do check the thyroid. We have an orthopedic foundation. There's the orthopedic foundation, and it tells you on that certificate what age the dog was when it was registered, and also whether the hips are good, excellent, and you'll see like a number, and I'm trying to, yeah, all the way down. Underneath the number 20, you'll see some numbers like 4035, I don't have my glasses on, 4035, and then it says E. That means the dog has excellent hips, and that's where you would look for it. There's a letter in the middle of all those little numbers.
Right. And it shows the age of the dog also.
Yes, it shows that right behind it.
Right.
Right, how many months the dog was when the dog was actually certified as having excellent hips. And it says on the bottom that the hip report shows that the dog's hips were excellent. So that it would show either excellent, good, or fair.
Or fair.
Right. If the dog's hips are not fair or up, they don't get a certificate. So if they can't show you this thing showing what the hips actually were certified as, they didn't have the dog certified or the hips were that bad, which means dysplasia. This is the canine eye registration, and this is your CERF. C-E-R-F, because Canine Eye Registration Foundation is way too long to say, so we say CERF. And it, too, tells you whether the dog had any eye problems at all. So these are the things that you would want to get, or at least see. Most breeders, do you give copies of this when you give your puppy packets out?
I do not, but on your AKC registration,
It's also listed.
If you get your registration certificate to fill out and send in to register your puppy, underneath the dog's name, each dog, the father's name and the mother's name, it'll have a DNA if its dog is DNA'd.
Mm-hmm.
It will have a CERF number. It will have an OFA number. Any certificates that the AKC recognizes, any health clearances, they will all be on that dog's registration. So you don't have to even see the paperwork. It'll be right there. If it's not there, it's not done.
Right. But before you even buy the puppy, you should see these things before you even buy the puppy.
Or so, even if you don't buy the puppy and they show you this is the litter registration, here is the numbers.
Mm-hmm.
That's sufficient, because sometimes we don't have our paperwork close by.
That's true. Candy, do any other health screenings on your puppies other than the CERF, the OFA, possibly
cyber? The puppies are the parents.
The parents.
We do VWD testing, which is von Willebrand's.
Okay.
And with that, they're considered affected, carrier, or clear.
Okay.
So
now, von Willebrand's is hemophilia.
A form of hemophilia in dogs. It's a bleeding disorder.
It's a bleeding disorder. That's exactly right. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you go to cut a nail, if the puppy does have, you know, the von Willebrand's, and you go to cut a nail, your puppy may bleed to death. You're going to have to race it over to the vet, that's for sure. Where are your puppies raised? Where do you raise your puppies? Outside?
In the house. My last litter was raised in my dining room. I usually would raise my puppies. I have an area down in the lower level of my house. And had a puppy area set up there, but because of some health considerations on myself with knees, this last litter was raised in the middle of my dining room, and so they were exposed to every single noise in the house. Vacuum cleaner, they learned to race and play with the vacuum cleaner. They learned to know when the little spoon banged on the dish that they were going to get fed. All kinds of really good, neat things that all puppies should know about.
The doorbell.
The doorbell and food and TV and people and the whole thing.
Wow. And Candy, your puppies are raised where?
My little guys are raised, they started down in the spare bedroom. Because with Corgis, Corgi mothers are not real good with other dogs around. So I cordon them off completely.
Okay.
And then after that, they run around in the bedroom. They run around in our downstairs. And just have a gay old time. And again, they're socialized to all kinds of noises and sounds and other people as soon as they have their first set of shots.
Okay. Why do you raise your puppies in the house? What's the benefit of raising them in the house?
A nicer puppy.
Well, they're going to live in a house eventually, mm-hmm. so they should know what a house is before they ever go into a new home. It's bad enough going from one environment to another, but they shouldn't have to be worried about stair steps or noises of vacuum cleaners or washing machines or TV. They should be used to all of that, and it's very social. Now, Candy socializes her puppies maybe a little bit later than I do, I have people come in to visit my puppies from the age of 3 weeks on.
Okay.
Because their eyes are open at 3 weeks, their ears are open at 3 weeks, and from then on in, there's a parade of individuals through the home because it's really good for them to hear different voice levels.
Mm-hmm.
And it's good especially for children to come and visit because children move and talk differently than adults do.
That's correct.
And if they're not accustomed to that, they might be frightened by it. And so the more people that they see, the better it is. So after the age of 3 weeks until they leave, house is sort of Grand Central Station.
But I guess, too, my feeling would be if the puppy is raised in the house as opposed to outside or in the barn or in the kennel or wherever, you're going to have a cleaner puppy. Because let's face
it, they're naturally clean.
If your puppy goes in the house, you're going to clean it up right away because it stinks.
Mm-hmm.
But if the puppy goes outside in the yard or the barn or the kennel, you don't have to clean it up. You're not right there. So maybe you're only cleaned up once a day, maybe once a week, or only when somebody's coming. So it's easier to housebreak a puppy when they're used to being clean.
Oh, yes.
You both agree with me there?
And dogs are naturally clean animals.
They are.
They would prefer not to mess the area that they sleep in.
Right.
And so the easier it is for them to leave that area, the faster they learn and they immediately transfer it over to their new home.
Yes.
And so it's amazing how if you work with a puppy, the puppy will do whatever
mm-hmm.
for you.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yes.
Now that we're talking about puppies going into their new home, what age do they leave your house?
In my breed, we like them to leave somewhere around the 8 week stage.
8 weeks.
Especially since we have usually litters of 9 or 11.
Mm-hmm.
And by that time, they need to be separated from each other. And they are bigger puppies. And so it is time for them to start adjusting to their new homes.
Okay.
So we let our puppies go a little bit earlier. I know some breeds are very different.
Yes.
And so every breed, you have to work with what is best for that breed.
Well, I think the people with the toy dogs, they don't ever send their puppies out before they're 12 to 16 weeks.
Exactly.
So what about you, Candy?
10 weeks.
10 weeks. Okay.
Yeah, 10 weeks is pretty much the earliest I will let any of them leave.
Because of the size or?
I just feel in the corgis, they need that bonding. They need the bonding with the mother. They need the bonding with the siblings. I placed them a little earlier years ago and they just don't, I don't know. I've had problems.
I've had
people call me back with different problems. 10 weeks, they're at a very good age to go. They've been started on crate training. Now they're babies, so
sure.
They're going to have
that's
accidents.
Exactly right.
But at 10 weeks, that's the earliest that
okay.
I usually let
so
them go.
So they probably mature mentally a little later, not necessarily
yeah.
physically,
mm-hmm.
of course, physically, but mentally probably a little bit mm-hmm. later than the larger breeds do. But I know with the toy dogs, they never let them go before 12 weeks.
Exactly, and they're more
mm-hmm.
fragile.
That's exactly right.
Dalmatians are notoriously extremely hardy.
Yes.
They're very hardy, and by the time that they're 8 weeks of age, they are really ready to do a lot of new experiences.
Mm-hmm.
And so to not allow them to have those experiences really delays their development then.
Yes, I agree.
And so it's much better for them.
What about, I buy a puppy from you, and maybe a year down the road, I'm having a real hard time with this dog. Could I call you back and say, what's going on here? What do I do?
Absolutely. I think both of us.
Well, if you bought a puppy from me, if I hadn't heard from you in that year, there'd be a real problem because when you buy a puppy from me, you get me for your life.
Uh-oh.
I am calling and emailing and talking to all of my puppy people in the very beginning, almost weekly.
Okay.
And then it is somewhere around the 4 month stage. I want to know what's happening. Have they gone to puppy kindergarten? Is the puppy house broken? If it's not, why isn't it? What's going on? At 6 months of age, then I want to know, has it been neutered? If it hasn't, when's it scheduled for?
Mm-hmm.
And et cetera. So you will have heard from me many times in that year.
Okay.
So
you're sort of already.
I'm a very hands-on kind of person.
Okay. You're already taking a proactive approach.
Oh, you betcha.
Rather than a reactive approach.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
And
definitely.
You're the same way, Candy.
Yes.
You would be calling all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'm assuming both of you sell with a contract.
Oh, yes.
Okay. What is covered in your contract?
In my contract, it also states that if the dog needs to be returned for any reason, that he comes back to me.
Okay.
Specifically.
Okay.
That's in big, bold letters.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And yours, Nancy, is?
Mine doesn't state it quite that way. It says that I need to know if there's a problem, and if we can rehome the dog without it coming back to me, we will work on do that.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Because it's easier on the dog rather than making three transitions.
Yes.
All right. So we will work with that. It doesn't happen often. But also the contract is that it must be neutered within a certain age.
Mm-hmm.
And I must see proof of that. Now, of course, with the AKC limited registration, that has made life easier because they can't use it for breeding because no puppies will be registered. Also, we do guarantee with the health in that you must take the puppy to your vet
mm-hmm.
within a certain period of time.
Okay.
And if there's a problem, it comes back to me immediately.
Okay.
Again, I've been, knock on wood, very fortunate. I've never had to take a puppy back, but I know they're healthy when they leave.
Mm-hmm.
So
if somebody says, well, I'm not going to sign that because I don't want to have my puppy neutered.
Thanks. It was nice meeting you. Goodbye.
Okay. So you don't sell them the puppy.
Oh, no.
Right.
No.
Right. Okay.
They all know that before. When they give me a deposit on a puppy, they're well aware of that way up front.
Okay.
And if they're not willing to do that way up front, I have too many people waiting for puppies. I don't need you.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So goodbye. Find another puppy.
Right. Would you, you said that you allow people in when the puppies are 3 weeks old.
Yes.
So then they would meet the mother of the litter at that point,
yes.
as well as the other dogs that you have?
Always. I always make sure that they, well, normally a lot of people come even before the puppies are born.
Okay.
They meet the mother before the puppies are even born. They always have to meet all of my other dogs.
Okay.
If they aren't comfortable with the adults, then we need to rethink what's going to happen.
Okay.
But yes. Now, they might not necessarily meet the father, because a lot of times the father is a dog who lives in a different state or
mm-hmm.
sometimes in Canada.
Mm-hmm.
So they're not going to necessarily meet the father of the puppies, but they will always get to meet the mother.
Yes. Candy, you're all the same way?
Yeah, I like the kids to come in. I like the whole family to come. If
mm-hmm.
there's a family of a couple kids, I want the kids to come in. I want them to sit down. I want them to meet the other dogs. I also, with having corgis for all these years, when you have corgis, you have hair.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to see, if you're a meticulous housekeeper, you don't want a corgi.
Mm-hmm.
Because they have a double coat and they shed.
Right. Well, the Dalmatian shed is
all right.
You can take a look at the floor.
The floor is white.
Yeah,
we've just redecorated the studio.
So I'd like to meet the whole family before I decide if they're right for me. And I was telling Pat before, Kelly, this puppy's mother, was what we call a pupsicle. She was conceived by frozen semen. We had lost the sire years ago.
Okay.
And so
it would be impossible to see the father.
And in some cases it is. And nowadays, with using chilled and frozen semen more, you don't see a lot of the sires of the litters.
Right. And especially if you're getting them from, you know, a goodly distance away. You know, you can use a sire from, you know, Timbuktu. And all they do would be to send the chilled semen, and you would go to your vet, and they would impregnate the bitch with the frozen semen or, you know, the chilled semen. If I asked you before I come to see the puppies, or when I come to see the puppies, would you give me the name of your vet so I could call and check your references? Would you find that objectionable?
Never. I would happy to do that. The same as if they've had a dog before, I want to know the name of their vet.
Okay.
And so, oh heavens no, that they're more than welcome.
So then you would also say, you know, if you want to check up on me, here are other people who bought my breed, please call them?
Right, exactly.
And Candy, you would be the same way?
Oh yeah.
So,
absolutely.
You know, really, you sort of, if you're speaking with a reputable breeder, they're going to be interviewing you the same way that you are interviewing them. So you want to have a list of questions. What you want to ask these people, just look at this, you know. What you want to ask this breeder before you go to see the puppies. Now, how could you go to see either one of these puppies or
she's
the
7
litter?
Years.
Oh, she's 7 years
she's
old?
She's 7 years old.
Oh, I thought
old.
She was a puppy. Oh, my
no,
God.
No, she's not. Well, she's a puppy in heart.
Well, yeah, but...
She's already had she, a lot of puppies.
She oh. is also liver and white. It's not your television.
Yes, it's not she, your she television. Is not. She is brown, yes.
Yes, she is a liver and white.
And she's being very tolerant of the little
yes,
brat.
Yes, she is.
But I can... She says,
well,
Mom...
Well, now that we know how old Brandy is, how old is Christine?
Christine's 12 weeks old.
Okay, so we have a 12-week-old and a 7-year-old. And, okay, that's enough.
I don't blame her.
And the puppy's ears, Corgi's ears, do stand up. This puppy, because it is only 12 weeks old, his ear, her ears yeah. will stand, right?
Yeah, they will. She's teething, too.
That is another reason that ears will go down. A lot of people think, and they probably would call Candy and say, oh, my God, the ears went down.
Yes, they
because
do.
Because at 8 weeks old, they may be both standing up or mm-hmm. 9 weeks old and then just sort of flop over. And it's like, oh, my word. Geez, this dog is ruined already. I've only had it 3 weeks. What does he look like with his ears up? She look like with her ears up.
Yeah, there we go. Oh, they're both up.
Look at that. They have these huge mule ears. Actually, even as adults, they have huge mule ears. Don't they?
Aww. Don't listen.
Quick, put your ears down.
You should pay too.
Also, I would assume that if there is a major life change, say you sold a puppy and maybe 2 months, 3 months later, the person calls you back and says, you know, I have to go into the hospital for a major surgery. Would you board that puppy? Would you take that puppy back?
We've done both.
Okay.
We've done it both ways.
Okay.
It just depends on the circumstances of what the life change is and how temporary or long-term it's going to be and what would be best for the puppy.
Okay. Okay. Well, I thank you, ladies. I think that was very informative. So you need to know what you are going to do, questions you are going to ask before you go to see a litter of puppies. This is the only way you're going to know what you're getting. So for this evening, that's our program. Next month, we're going to have a really interesting program. It's going to be a woman who spins dog hair. Everybody watch it
we'll
just in case. I mean, she spins it and she gives it back to you, and you can do whatever you want
to
with
it. She can't use this really short stuff,
she can't really use that really short hair. But anyhow, that's our program for this evening, so good night.
Look at all that hair.
About Dogs on VCTV is supported by the Berks County Kennel Club and by the Berks County Dog Training Club.